We're the History Detectives, and we're going to investigate some untold stories from America's past. This week, we lift off with an hour devoted to the pioneers of flight. Is this piece of fabric a remnant from the first transatlantic flight 8 years before Lindbergh?
Wow.
Was this the instrument that charted Howard Hughes' near fatal plunge into Beverly Hills?
And an encore presentation. Is this all that remains of the Union Army's most secret weapon?
Watching the detectives. Get so angry when the teardrops start. But you can't be wounded because you got no heart. Watching the detectives. It's just like watching the detectives.
This program was made possible by contributions to local PBS stations by viewers like you. Thank you.
Our first story examines a swatch of fabric which may be from one of history's most forgotten milestones, the world's first transatlantic flight. May 17, 1919, the Portuguese Azores. Men in whaling ships watch the sea for their prey, harpoons at the ready. But on this morning, they make an unexpected and otherworldly sighting. A huge gray flying machine emerges from the fog, making a roar unlike anything they have ever heard before. Six American airmen ride 20,000 pounds of wood, metal, fabric, and fuel, and plunge gently into the bay, ending the flight of the NC-4. It was a journey many had thought impossible. For the first time, men had flown from America to Europe, crossing the vast Atlantic Ocean. But strangely, while their voyage was 8 years before Charles Lindbergh's flight, few Americans have ever heard of the NC-4. Almost 90 years later, a woman from Saratoga, California, has an unusual family heirloom that she believes was a part of this milestone in aviation history. I'm Elise Leray, and I'm on my way to meet Shelley Monfort and hear her story.
Hi.
Hi, Elise.
Nice to meet you.
Come on in.
So is this something that has always been in your family?
Yeah, it was passed down from my grandparents. Here it is.
Ah, there it is.
Yep.
Okay. So this is the fabric. Wow, it's in wonderful condition.
Yeah, it's been in the envelope for years and years. And there's an inscription on the other side.
Uh-huh.
That's written by my grandmother.
This is a piece of the original fabric that covered the wings of the NC-4, the first plane to cross the Atlantic by our Navy, May 31st, 1919. I think most people think of Lindbergh as crossing the Atlantic for the first time.
I think they do. Lindbergh made the first solo nonstop flight across the Atlantic, but it was some years earlier that a Navy plane, the NC-4, made the very first flight.
Shelley tells me that she has an intimate connection to the flight. Her step-grandfather, Walter Hinton, was the NC-4's pilot.
I have a picture of him here with my grandmother, Sally, in front of the NC-4 just before he made the transatlantic flight.
Oh, nice.
If you look on the back, there's an inscription that my grandmother wrote.
Walter and Sally Hinton sitting in NC-4 before Walter flew to England May 31st, 1919. God, they look so young.
Yeah, and she must have been nervous.
And what exactly do you want me to find out?
Well, I guess I have two questions. One is, can you connect this piece of fabric with the original NC-4 aircraft? And the second question is, why is it that this flight is so little known?
Well, I'm gonna have to take the fabric with me.
Okay.
And I'll see what I can find out.
Sounds great.
If this fabric really is from the first plane to cross the Atlantic, it's a great bit of history. It's linen, and the course weave tells me that it's old, so dating it from 1919 is reasonable. But the more I examine the fabric itself, the more skeptical I'm feeling. The linen has almost no signs of wear. It's hard to believe that it could have been on the wings of a plane that flew the Atlantic. I'm one of those people who'd never heard of the NC-4, so my first task is to learn more about its historic flight. As early as 1913, aviators are racing to be the first across the Atlantic. That's just 10 years after the Wright brothers first took to the air. During World War I, the U.S. Navy developed an experimental long-range seaplane to guard American shipping against deadly U-boat submarines.
It's a biplane, and the wings are massive.
After the war ended in 1918, the Navy decided their new fabric-covered flying boat would be given the ultimate test, to conquer the Atlantic. Because of the danger, there were three legs to the journey. New York to Newfoundland, a marathon 1,389-mile trip to the Azores, followed by the final leg to Lisbon, Portugal. On May 8, 1919, three NC aircraft left New York, but only Walter Hinton's NC-4 made it all the way to Lisbon. Newspaper accounts of the flight make it clear to me that the Navy airmen were certainly famous in their day.
This is impressive. After completing the first solo transatlantic flight 8 years after the NC-4, Charles Lindbergh had this to say. I had a better chance of reaching Europe in the spirit of St. Louis than the NC boats had of reaching the Azores. I had a more reliable type of engine, improved instruments, and a continent instead of an island for a target.
It's hard to imagine how this remarkable flight could have faded from public awareness. But my first task is to learn more about Shelley's fabric. Traff Doherty is director of the Glenn H. Curtis Museum in Hammondsport, New York. NC stands for Navy Curtis. Traff tells me how Glenn Curtis became a major force in early aviation.
Curtis is considered the founder of the American aircraft industry. But a century ago, he was a motorcycle manufacturer. And because of his lightweight engines, he was drawn into aviation by people who wanted to experiment and use his engines in their craft.
I tell Traff about Shelley's piece of linen.
Yes, he did.
He explains how fabric also helped make early planes light enough to fly. He has a perfect illustration for me.
Wow, this is incredible.
The museum is building an authentic reproduction of a 1914 Curtis America flying boat. It was the precursor to the NC-4.
Fabric is used just about everywhere. It's used to cover the planking on the fuselage, and the flying surfaces such as the tail assembly here, and also on a wing panel like this. This is the one panel we haven't covered yet.
Wow, it's beautiful. It's like a piece of artwork.
This is a typical wing structure of the period, at least, made mostly of ash and spruce.
The fabric is like the skin.
That's exactly right. The fabric forms a covering over the structure of the wing.
I want to see what Treff thinks of Shelley's piece of linen.
So here's the fabric, and I would love to get your opinion.
Let's take a look.
What do you think?
It's linen, it's coarse weave, definitely from around World War I. The only problem I have with it is if it were used on an aircraft, it would be impregnated with dope. If this were used on the airframe of the NC-4, it would have to probably be colored dope, either yellow or gray. This is not. This is still raw fabric.
Traff shows me how a liquid adhesive and sealer, called dope, attaches the fabric to the wing. Next, it's fixed more firmly with rib stitching.
To the ribs for the stitching problem.
Finally, more dope is applied, making the wing airtight and waterproof.
Could it have been used inside the aircraft?
The NC-4 is a flying boat. There's water everywhere, so everything had to be sealed against water and air. So being this is raw, I'd say not.
It's pretty clear that Shelley's fabric couldn't be from the NC-4's historic flight. I'm curious how her grandmother could have been so wrong. In the meantime, I want to figure out why Walter Hinton and the other NC-4 crew have been largely forgotten today. Traff told me that the original NC-4 is on display at the National Museum of Naval Aviation in Pensacola, Florida. I'm meeting John Bayer, a Navy lieutenant whose long flights over the Atlantic gave him a special vantage on the men of the NC-4.
So this is a P-3 Orion. It could be kind of thought of as the descendant of the NC-4. And back in the early 80s when I was flying on these hunting Russian submarines in the North Atlantic, I used to think often about the NC-4 and the conditions they faced.
John suggests the best way to really understand what the NC-4 airmen experienced is to see their plane face to face.
So here's the NC-4. It's the centerpiece of the collection here at the museum.
Wow, it's huge.
Yeah, it is. It has a wingspan about that of a 727. It was the largest aircraft of its time, way more complex than anything else you'd have seen during the First World War.
It looks like a boat with wings.
And that's exactly what it is, basically. They launched it and recovered it just like a boat. flying the airplane was really something because you were exposed to the elements. And if you like to get up in the cockpit, you can see kind of what it was like in those days.
Yeah, I'd love to.
Okay. This is great. Not too many people get this view.
I might take my shoes off a bit.
Okay.
Oh, sorry.
Wow.
So here you are at the controls of the NC-4.
It's tiny.
Yeah, it really is, you know. And imagine you're sitting here for 15 hours at the controls. You're in an open cockpit. You're being hit by the wind blast. You just have a pair of goggles and this little windshield to protect you. So, you know, fog, rain, sleet, whatever, you're out here in the elements. 70 miles an hour for over 15 hours. So every time the tail surfaces were hit by a strong gust of wind, they were buffeted.
Right.
And they're both hanging on to the control wheel here and being shook by the force of the wind. You can't take your hands off the controls. You can't take a break. And you basically had no relief for the 15 hours there on the flight from Newfoundland to the Azores. If they lost sight of the surface of the ocean, the two pilots could easily become disoriented and crash the airplane.
So given the odds and the elements that they were up against, this was just an unbelievable accomplishment.
It was. I don't know many pilots that would be up to it today because it was pretty dangerous for the time.
So why don't more people know about it?
Well, you know, the war just ended 6 months prior. People were getting pretty tired of war, I think. So anything having to do with the military kind of got downplayed a little, and they basically were moving into the roaring 20s, you know, time to have fun. So they wanted to put it all behind them.
John says there's another reason people don't remember the NC-4, perhaps the biggest one.
Just 2 weeks later, you had Alcock and Brown, two British pilots, who crossed the Atlantic nonstop from Newfoundland, Ireland.
The NC-4 had opened the door to a golden age of aviation. But ironically, the great flights of the 1920s by Charles Lindbergh, Richard Byrd, and Amelia Earhart quickly eclipsed the headlines from the NC-4's flight.
There were so many aviation firsts that happened in such a short span of time. People were logically and naturally ready to move on to the next set of heroes every time there was a new headline.
That answers Shelley's second question, but I'm still wondering how her grandmother could have been so wrong about her NC-4 fabric.
I can tell you it's probably old aircraft fabric, but that's about all I can tell you about it right now.
Any suggestions?
John does pass on a potentially valuable clue. The museum holds an extensive collection of artifacts related to the NC-4. Hill Goodspeed, the museum's historian, says their archive holds many papers and artifacts related to the NC-4 flight, including some original fabric.
Oh, maybe that's where my fabric is.
So I have two samples I wanted to show you.
Okay.
The first one was removed by an employee of the Curtis plant in Garden City, New York, where it was built.
And you have documentation for this?
We sure do. And was removed following the transatlantic flight, according to his letter he sent in when he donated it.
It's been doped.
Definitely. It's very rigid. Obviously looks like it has a lot of wear and tear.
Yeah.
And stained in places.
Right.
And looking at that, you would think that that had gone through an experience like the transatlantic flight where it had really been exposed to the elements.
And what's this?
This is another piece of fabric, which is obviously you can see it has not been doped.
The fabric that Hill shows me looks and feels a lot like Shelley's. And when I see the handwriting on the back, it's clear we've stumbled onto something important.
My
husband,
Lieutenant Walter Hinton, August 1919, signed by Mrs. Walter Hinton.
Oh, that's Shelley's grandmother.
Huh, well, that's interesting because I have this envelope written by Shelley's grandmother. And if you look closely.
Well, that writing looks pretty similar.
Walter looks almost identical. The W, the
right,
L,
the T,
the G.
Definitely. This looks almost identical.
Her signature is identical. I mean, there's no doubt in my mind that this and this were written by the same person.
I would agree.
The date on the museum's fabric is curious. August 1919 is 3 months after the NC-4 made its transatlantic voyage. So what's the connection between these pieces of fabric and the NC-4? Hill and I dive back into the Naval Museum's archive.
Elise, take a look at this.
Did you find something?
I think so. This is a copy of the Bureau of Aeronautics newsletter. And here's one from Rockaway, Long Island, New York, which was an air station, August 23rd, 1919. And beneath about three items, you have mention of the NC-4.
What Hill showed me next allowed me to wrap up my investigation. I'm headed back to tell Shelley what I've learned.
Your grandmother's story isn't true. The fabric is not from the original NC-4.
Wow.
Are you upset?
No, but I'm surprised, definitely. It kind of makes you wonder what Grandma was talking about all those years. And I'm wondering where the fabric really came from.
Well, it turns out it was used for something unique and a little special in the history of naval aviation.
This is a copy of the Bureau of Aeronautics newsletter, August 23rd, 1919.
The NC-4 at the present time is at the Curtis plant in Garden City being overhauled. It is expected back in the near future to be erected for its proposed recruiting trip. So the plane was being used for recruiting purposes?
That's correct. After all, it had flown the Atlantic, and the Navy wanted to take advantage of the positive publicity that came out of that.
NC-4 crew, including Shelley's step-grandfather Walter Hinton, went on a recruitment tour to drum up interest in the burgeoning Navy aviation program.
They hit places from Maine to Texas and all the way up the Mississippi River and exposed just countless thousands to naval aviation.
Everywhere it went, the NC-4 and its crew was given a hero's welcome by a public fascinated by the new technology. The Navy wanted the famous NC-4 to look its best, so it had been resurfaced for the tour.
So that's probably what these two pieces of fabric were used for.
I would say so, because the aircraft had been, after all, flying the Atlantic over thousands of miles and was battered by the elements, and they wanted to make sure it was airworthy, and part of that was putting new fabric on the aircraft.
That's a great story. I had no idea.
The National Museum of Naval Aviation had some unique NC-4 artifacts in their collection that I knew Shelley would be eager to see. Some of the commendations and awards her step-grandfather, Walter Hinton, received after making his historic flight.
And this is something that I think is really special. It's a watch that was given to your step-grandfather, and if you turn it over, you can see the inscription on the back.
From Glenn Curtis to Lieutenant Walter Hinton, USN, pilot NC-4, commemorating the first transatlantic flight. That's just incredible. Thank you so much for bringing the story to me. So many aspects of it, I had no idea.
Although Shelley's fabric wasn't from the first transatlantic flight, investigating its origins allowed me to appreciate one of the U.S. Navy's finest hours. War weariness and a tidal wave of aviation achievements soon eclipsed the NC-4 in the public's mind. But for one brief shining moment, the plane and its men captured the national imagination in a way no one had ever done before.
To see more of my interview with John Bayer and to learn more about the NC-4, go to History Detectives on the web at pbs.org.
Charles Lindbergh's dramatic feat made him the most famous aviator of an aviation-crazed era. There were other figures, too, less well-known, but no less venturesome. Frustrated by racial prejudice in the 1920s, African-American Bessie Coleman went to France to study aviation. She became the first American woman with an international pilot's license. She then returned home to become a popular barnstorming pilot around the Midwest, and she began raising money for a school for black aviators. In 1926, at a rehearsal for an air show in Florida, Coleman's plane suddenly lurched into a tailspin, flinging her 2,000 feet to her death. The colorful Roscoe Turner combined skill with showmanship to become an audience favorite at air shows in the 1930s, when he wasn't grabbing attention with his striking uniform and his occasional cockpit partner, a lion cub named Gilmore. Turner was setting transcontinental speed records. In 1933, Wiley Post made the first solo flight around the world. 2 years later, Post was on a journey with the beloved American humorist, Will Rogers, when the plane crashed off the coast of Alaska, killing both men. The telling of history can sometimes be myopic, focusing solely on a few heroes. As we celebrate the aviator Charles Lindbergh, it's important to remember those other pioneers whose courage and sacrifice were often just as commendable.
Our next story examines an instrument that may have recorded the desperate moments of a tycoon's near-fatal flight. July 7, 1946, the world's fastest military spy plane is about to launch on its maiden voyage. And the test pilot is as extraordinary as the plane itself. Howard Hughes, billionaire Hollywood playboy and aviation wizard. But 75 minutes into flight, the plane suddenly plummets at over 125 miles an hour, diving into a wealthy Beverly Hills neighborhood, smashing three homes and nearly killing Hughes. The crash scars Hughes physically and mentally, marking the beginning of his lifelong addiction to painkillers. Now, some 60 years later, a man in Laramie, Wyoming, has inherited a curious item, which he believes may have recorded Hughes' near-deadly descent. I'm Tekufu Zuberi, and I'm meeting up with Jim Kirkpatrick.
So what do you got for me?
Well, I have an altimeter that my father says came out of the XF-11 airplane that Hughes crashed into Beverly Hills.
Okay, it's an altimeter, so it measures the altitude of a plane.
That's correct.
Jim tells me his dad worked for Howard Hughes for over 30 years.
What exactly did he do?
When he hired on as an aircraft mechanic, and then he worked his way up to flight engineering, co-pilot, that sort of thing. This is a picture of my dad. He's on the far left. This is one of Hughes' airplanes.
Was your dad there on the day of the crash?
He was part of the crew, and he was among many people who were standing around waiting for the plane to come back, and it never did. So after the crash, he was on the investigation team, and of course he had access to the entire set of wreckage.
Now, what is it you want me to find out?
What I want to find out if his story is really true.
Well, let me go see what I can find out.
It's a fascinating story. A billionaire playboy barely escapes death in the biggest plane crash in Hollywood history. And right here, maybe the instrument that charted Hughes' near-fatal descent. Jim's dad certainly had access to the crash, but I have no idea if this is the real thing. It's a solid black metal case, pretty heavy, and it looks old.
I have no idea how old, but it does have some information on it. Here is a name, Colesman. And it looks like they put this little 9 here.
The number appears to have been painted on.
And there is a manufacturer part number 671BK03. Maybe I can find a crash report that lists this altimeter.
I'm calling the National Archive in Washington, D.C. I want to know if they have any files on the plane crash.
For the XF-11.
While the archive searches their records, it's time to do some digging of my own. Last year, my colleague Gwen Wright investigated Howard Hughes Sr. and how he earned his fortune in the oil business. Howard Jr. was born into riches and went on to make Hollywood films and set world speed records in aviation. He became a national hero. But Hughes was eager to make bigger contributions. As World War II raged, a serious problem emerged in the Air Force. Reconnaissance planes flew too low and slow. They were often shot down. Hughes proposes the XF-11, a new kind of spy plane. Traveling at over 400 miles an hour at 30,000 feet, the plane would be a powerful new espionage weapon. On July 7, 1946, the plane is ready for testing, with Hughes at the controls. The scene was dramatically recreated in the hit movie, The Aviator.
It says here that the filmmakers on The Aviator used meticulous primary research to recreate the planes that Hughes flew.
The XF-11 in the film is a near-perfect recreation. There's even a shot of the altimeter in the film, but it doesn't look anything like ours. I'll need to talk to the folks who made the film. But first, I'm meeting a guy who might know if this is the kind of altimeter that would have been in a Hughes airplane.
How you doing?
Hi, doing fine.
George Merritt was a test pilot for Hughes Aviation for over 20 years. I'm meeting him in Beverly Hills, in the exact spot where Hughes crashed back in 1946.
Tell me what happened on that day.
Howard took off in his XF-11 from his airport at Culver City for what was scheduled to be about a 45-minute flight.
So when did he notice that he had trouble?
He had been airborne for now about an hour and 25 minutes, and what Howard Hughes did not know at that time was that there was a leak in the right rear propeller, and it went into reverse. He now is in an airplane that has no ejection seat. He's over a populated area, and he's going down.
Describe the crash to me.
He is coming in this direction. Mm-hmm. He is descending. He's trying to stretch it to a golf course, which is about two blocks over here. Okay. Unfortunately, he doesn't have the altitude, and his left landing gear goes through the roof of this house. As he continues through this two-story house here, his right wing hits this house, and the airplane now starts to come apart. He had a utility pole, parts and pieces flying off.
None of the residents on the ground were injured, but Hughes barely survived.
He ended up with a crushed chest, collapsed lung. He had multiple broken bones. He had second and third degree burns over all of his body.
This altimeter that
I showed George our altimeter.
Do you think this came out of that plane?
It was a very common instrument made by a company called Colesman Manufacturing, who made all of the altimeters for military aircraft of that vintage. I can tell you definitely from my aviation background and experience, this is the type of altimeter that would have been on Howard Hughes' XF-11 when he crashed.
What about this red number on the back?
Typically, when people investigate accidents, what they will do is mark the equipment and then gather it all up, take it to laboratories, and do the evaluation. So I think that adds credence to the fact that this altimeter could have been in that crash.
But I still need proof that this exact altimeter was in Hughes' plane. It seems like the company that made it is still around.
Hello, yes.
I'm calling about an altimeter you made back in 1946.
It was an XF-11.
Any records, any?
671BK-03.
Your records don't go back that far?
No reference to it. None at all.
I'm headed off to meet with the filmmakers from the Aviator movie. I wonder where they did their research. Matthew Gratzner owns New Deal Studios in Los Angeles. His crew of model makers spent thousands of hours meticulously recreating an accurate version of the crash.
With most films, there's a lot of artistic license, but The Aviator, it's a historical drama, so any piece of material is realistically and accurately portrayed as possible.
How much research did you conduct to get the scene right?
We went through any accounts we could find and tried to do almost like a forensic study of how the crash happened.
I asked Matthew what records of the XF-11 he was able to uncover.
For the exterior of the airplane, we ended up referencing real photographs of the XF-11, which were kind of few and far between. But for the interior of the cockpit, there really was almost no photo reference, nor blueprints or any types of drafting. So I know that because the XF-11 looked very similar to the P-38 Lightning, the Lockheed aircraft of World War II, they based a lot of the instrumentation on that aircraft.
No wonder our altimeter doesn't match theirs. It wasn't even from the right plane. Maybe there are no surviving photos of the XF-11 cockpit. Was our altimeter even in a plane crash? Ray Grimsbo of Intermountain Forensic Laboratories has investigated dozens of crashes.
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm fine.
I'm back into the lab.
Great.
I'm trying to find out if this altimeter was in a crash in 1946 over Beverly Hills. Is there any way you can help me out?
Yeah, I think so. We're going.
Ray explains there's a number of tests he can do. First, he takes an alcohol swab to search for hydrocarbons, the residual smoke left behind after a fire or explosion.
And once we pick up the residue, we'll extract it into the alcohol.
When he's gathered a good sample, Ray brings it to the machine room.
What we're going to do now is we're going to inject 1 microliter of this sample into the gas chromatograph. Okay. And in 20 minutes, we'll see if we have hydrocarbons or not.
Okay.
Inside the gas chromatograph, a laser pulverizes our sample, turning it into ions, helping to reveal which elements are present.
So what do we got?
No hydrocarbons. Oh. This is all background noise, and there's no hydrocarbons there.
So does that mean that our altimeter was not in the crash?
No, it doesn't necessarily mean it hasn't been through a crash.
Ray explains that residue may have worn off in the intervening years. But Ray's looked at photos of the crash site, and he's skeptical any instrument could have survived such an impact.
it just seems to me that this altimeter should have shown more damage if it was in this type of crash. I don't see any evidence to indicate that it was in a crash of any sort.
A package from the National Archives gives my investigation a new twist. Seems my phone call to the archives led researchers to a crash report that hadn't been seen in decades. That report gives a thorough account of what happened on that day back in 1946. Unfortunately, there's no mention of an altimeter being recovered. But then I find a stack of photographs, stark images taken just hours after the crash.
Wow.
And on one of the photos, I find what I'm looking for.
What we have here is a photograph of the mangled cockpit.
The steering column blocks the spot where the altimeter would be, but it's clear that every other instrument is in great shape. Our altimeter could have been in that crash, but does Jim have the real thing? The Evergreen Aviation Museum in McMinnville, Oregon, is home to Howard Hughes' famous Spruce Goose, the largest airplane in the world. Their staff helped Winwright last year in her investigation. Maybe I can find original purchase orders that show the altimeter Hughes ordered for the XF-11. Registrar Aaron Workington turns me loose in the archives. I don't find any purchase orders, but I do uncover something curious.
What I found here is an oral history from one of the engineers who worked on the Spruce Goose.
The engineer says the Spruce Goose used engines called 4360s. In another document, an engineer notes that the XF-11 also used 4360s, the same engine. Aaron's not surprised. The two planes were built side by side and frequently used the same brand and model of parts.
So it would have been very easy for them to be using some of the same instruments. I need to look at the instruments in the Goose.
Okay, well, I can let you in.
The plane is enormous.
Let's see.
Inside are five separate altimeters. The first is made by Colesman, but it doesn't match ours.
The numbers are different, the needles are slightly different, and the dial is different.
At the next three stations, it's the same story, no match. Finally, at the most important seat in the Spruce Goose, I find what I'm looking for. It's time to head back to Jim.
Have a seat.
Thank you. Here's your altimeter.
Okay.
I show Jim the long-lost crash photos from the National Archives, proving that the XF-11 instruments survived the crash.
Okay, so we're on the right track.
But frustratingly, there was no photo of the altimeter.
But then our flight took a turn.
In the pilot seat of the Spruce Goose, I make a discovery.
The numbers, the same. The needles, the same. The colors are all the same. I think we got a match.
Jim's dad worked on the XF-11 crash team and had access to all the plane's parts. And now at the Spruce Goose, we have evidence that this exact make and model of altimeter was used in Hughes' aircraft during that period.
So if you take the evidence from my investigation and your father's firsthand report, it all points to this altimeter being the one from the XF-11 flight that Howard Hughes crashed in Beverly Hills in 1946.
Well, that's very exciting. I'm very glad to hear that. My dad was a really good storyteller, and although he's gone, this is still one more story that he can keep on telling.
9 months after the crash, Hughes was back in the cockpit to test another version of the XF-11. This time, the flight went without a hitch. With the end of the war, the XF-11 was never put into service, but it inspired the next generation of spy plane, the U-2, which provided military intelligence for over three decades.
Howard Hughes was always ready to push the bounds of science, above or below dry land. On April 11, 1968, naval intelligence had intercepted a signal from a Soviet nuclear sub. An onboard explosion had crippled the vessel in deep water, some 750 miles northwest of Hawaii. The Soviets gave up their efforts to recover the sub, along with its cargo of ballistic missiles. But Hughes secretly embarked on one of the most ambitious exercises in U.S. intelligence history. He told the public the ship he was building, the Glomar Explorer, was for mining undersea minerals. But in fact, the giant vessel planned to recover the entire submarine. In 1974, Glomar was launched and codenamed Project Jennifer. The sub was raised close to the surface, but then split into two, dumping nuclear missiles on the seafloor. The press got wind of the attempted submarine recovery after burglars broke into Hughes' office in LA and stole classified documents. But the CIA refused to either confirm or deny the Glomar story on the grounds that it would jeopardize national security.
In an encore broadcast, our last story examines the rise of U.S. military air power. It's July 24th, 1861, the early days of the war between the states. The nation's capital is panicked by rumors of Confederate troops advancing. Professor Thaddeus Lowe is ordered aloft in his balloon, the Enterprise, for a crucial mission. In what is one of the first instances of American military air reconnaissance, Lowe hovers directly above enemy lines and reports on any threatening troop movements. While Lowe's eye in the sky protected the Union, the fate of the Enterprise itself remains in question. Thomas Colgren of Midland, Michigan, believes he has the only remnant of this historic military balloon.
Well, I get a number of catalogs in the mail, and a lot of political items, a very small number of military items, actually, a lot of coins and buttons and that sort of thing. And I had never seen anything from Civil War ballooning. And I knew that there could not be too many pieces like this around.
I'm Wes Cowan, and I've come to meet with Tom to take a look at his unusual find and uncover the truth behind the fate of the Enterprise. Wes Cowan.
Hi, Tom Colgren. Let's
hey,
go inside.
Tom. Okay, Tom, what do you got for me?
Well, I brought you something I think is very, very interesting. I collect World War I aviation, but this is something that was in a catalog that jumped out of the page at me that goes back much earlier.
Okay. A piece of Professor Lowe's aeronautical balloon Enterprise taken by Lieutenant S. Millett Thompson of the 13th NHVI after it was destroyed upon landing near his camp on the peninsula in 1862. Professor Lowe has got to be Thaddeus Lowe, the Civil War balloonist, right?
Well, I think so, yes.
Wow, that's a neat thing. So what is it that you want me to find out?
Well, obviously, I'd like to know if that could be a piece of balloon fabric, and could it be from the Enterprise? And secondly, the story on the back, could that be true? And how would S. Millett Thompson have acquired this relic?
Gives me a lot to go on. You know, the walnut frame that this is framed in is not going to help us too much. I mean, it's the kind of frame that was used from the 1840s up to the present day. On the other hand, this label is just great. It's typed, and of course the typewriter didn't come into common usage until the mid-1870s, early 1880s, so it could have been put on any time, but the information on the label is really pretty great. There's no way we're gonna do it.
Yeah. Ah. Yeah.
So exactly who was Professor Thaddeus Lowe, and what was the Enterprise? I decided to get a unique perspective on Lowe's role in the Civil War from 2,000 feet up. My companion is Tom Crouch, an author and historian of ballooning in America. So Tom, tell me about this guy Thaddeus Lowe.
Well, Thaddeus Lowe really was, in a lot of ways, the founder of American air power. During the American Civil War, he commanded the Balloon Corps, created it, which made military observations for the Union Army, told them where the enemy was, what the positions were, that kind of thing.
For the first time in U.S. history, an army could spy on enemy troop movements and plan their own surprise counterattacks. So threatening were Lowe's balloons to the Confederate soldiers, the great poet and Civil War historian Carl Sandburg once wrote that Lowe was the single most shot at man in the war.
Well, how did he get Lincoln's ear? I mean, I hear that I understand that that's part of the story.
Joseph Henry, who was the head of the Smithsonian, arranged for Lowe to make a demonstration flight right on the mall where the Smithsonian is. And Lowe took a telegraph key up and, you know, he could telegraph down to the ground exactly what he could see.
So on June 18th, 1861, within full view of the White House, Lowe inflates the Enterprise and ascends 500 feet. From his bird's eye perch, Lowe sends President Lincoln a historic message. Lowe writes, "From this point of observation, we command an extent of country nearly 50 miles in diameter. I have the pleasure of sending you this first telegram ever dispatched from an aerial station. I am Your Excellency's obedient servant, T.S.C. Lowe."
Now, Lincoln was so taken, he invited Lowe into the White House, and they had a great discussion that evening. Lincoln was fascinated. And
Tom tells me that Lincoln was so enthused that he approved the construction of 6 brand new balloons for the Union Air Corps, paid for by the military.
You know, Tom, that's an amazing story about how Lowe launched the balloon corps. I want to go in now, though, for a landing, because I've got something I want to show you.
Hold on.
I just had a blast. You know, I wanted to show you this vis-a-vis the discussion we had about Lowe and his balloons that's purported to be a scrap of the Enterprise. Have you ever seen one of the Enterprise before?
I've never seen a piece of fabric from the Enterprise. But, you know, it's interesting. There's a long tradition of collecting little swatches of fabric from balloons, going all the way back to the beginning of the balloon.
Have you ever heard what happened to the Enterprise?
We really don't know. Lowe stops talking about the Enterprise in the summer of 1861 when his first real military balloon that the government paid for comes into service. And he just doesn't mention the Enterprise after that.
Huh.
So just what happened to the Enterprise? At least I know that it was used for observation flights during the Civil War. To figure out if Tom's artifact really is from the Enterprise, I've enlisted the help of a ballooning expert, Maureen Lynch, at the Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in Troy, New York. She's been a balloon pilot for 30 years and is an expert in the history of American ballooning.
What do you think?
The first thing I'm noticing is the color on it, and that is consistent with balloons of the period because the color is drawn mostly from the varnish.
Why would they use varnish? I always thought that varnish was something you use on wood.
Well, the varnish was put onto the fabric to make it gas tight because the lifting medium of the balloons was hydrogen gas. And because of that, it has to be as gas tight as possible. So you would use multiple layers of varnish. Most of the balloons built back then were made of either cotton or silk material.
Okay. Next question. Do we know what the Enterprise was made of?
I figured you were going to ask that.
Maureen tells me that according to Lowe's own account, the Enterprise was made of silk.
Okay, so what does our fabric look like?
Looking at this, there's a couple of threads that are loose on the edge. So I'm looking at those, and I also notice that there's a twist to the threads.
So what's a twist mean?
Cotton material has a twist in the threads because cotton fibers are short, mm-hmm. and you have to twist them together to bind them together and also give them added strength.
So if they're twisted fibers, it's got to be cotton.
Yes, absolutely.
Huh. Tom's fabric is made of cotton, not silk. So I assume it couldn't be a piece of the Enterprise. But Maureen explains that the balloons were frequently damaged on landing and carried cotton swatches for repairs and patches.
If you take a look at the sample and look closely on the center, you've got overlap here, which would be indicative of a seam. Most likely that would have been caused by a patch or a repair done on the balloon. We know that each of the balloons in Union service was equipped with reinforced cotton for fixing tears on the balloons.
So Tom's fabric could be balloon material from the Civil War. but I still don't know if it's a piece of the Enterprise.
The other possibility that I would want to take a look at, if this is in fact a patch or repair piece, then it could have gone to any one of, I believe, three balloons that were in operation on the peninsula at the time stated. It's entirely possible it's out of one of the other three balloons, but not necessarily the Enterprise.
Okay, what else do I need to do now?
Go find Dr. Priest down the hall and have him run a spectrometer trace on the sample.
I give the fabric to chemistry professor Dr. Ivor Priest. He's examined the fabrics of other 19th century balloons and knows their distinct characteristics. I've asked him to examine the chemical makeup of Tom's material using an X-ray spectrometer. Okay, what's this test we're going to be doing?
Basically, what the instrument does is to fluoresce the sample. That is, we'll shine some X-rays on it from this instrument onto your sample. That will excite the atoms in your sample, and they will give off radiation, and then we'll be able to tell you what chemical elements are there, and relatively speaking, what the amount of those chemical elements is.
Okay.
We can see calcium and iron and a little bit of cobalt and some lead coming up. And you can see that thing climbing there like crazy is zinc.
Zinc? Dr. Priest explains that the balloon operators in the 19th century used zinc powder to generate the hydrogen gas that inflated the balloons. The gas was then filtered through limestone to purify and clean it. The zinc spike on the screen may be telltale evidence that the balloon was launched by soldiers in a hurry.
If I was a soldier on the battlefield and some general yelled at me to get that balloon up in the air because there's 1,000 guys going over the hill, I probably wouldn't bother boiling it through some limestone, and I might have carried over an appreciable amount of this very fine zinc powder that got stuck in the fabric itself.
Wow, so it had that's a tantalizing prospect. Our forensic test suggests that this balloon may have been involved in direct conflict almost 150 years ago. Unfortunately, I'm not any closer to finding out if Tom's artifact is a piece of the Enterprise. Maybe the label can offer clues. The label says that the Enterprise was destroyed on the peninsula in 1862. That's got to refer to the Virginia Peninsula, where fierce battles were fought that year. But is that really what happened to the Enterprise? Author and historian Charles Evans has done extensive research on Lowe and his balloons.
Lowe's Enterprise. And what I want you to look at on the back is this great label.
Says that this was taken by this Lieutenant S. Millet Thompson in 1862.
From the date on this, Wes, it's not possible. This can't be from the Enterprise.
Wait a minute, how can you be so sure about that?
Lowe used the Enterprise around Washington, D.C. during the summer of 1861 and actually free-flighted the Enterprise near Arlington, Virginia in July of 1861. During that flight, however, the Enterprise was forced to make an emergency landing with Lowe aboard. When it landed, it was severely damaged by trees in a forest not far from Union lines.
So, Charles, what happened to the Enterprise?
Well, I believe the Enterprise was retired after August of 1861. Lowe obtained funding to have 6 additional balloons constructed by the end of 1861. So there was actually no more need for the Enterprise by that time.
So the label is obviously incorrect. This can't be a piece of the Enterprise.
Not from the date that we have supplied in the back of this frame, no.
I wonder if there's any truth to the information on the label. It says the fabric was discovered and saved by someone named S. Millet Thompson. After searching through some online bookstores, I've found a Civil War era volume published by someone of the same name, A History of the 13th Regiment of New Hampshire Volunteer Infantry, NHVI. Those letters match the initials on the label. Finally, I come across something. The book says that Professor Lowe was flying his balloons near where the New Hampshire Regiment was stationed on the Virginia Peninsula. Millet Thompson is the regiment's historian, and he makes several references to Lowe's balloons. Listen to this. The rebels send a small shell at Professor Lowe's balloon,
and it falls within our camp, makes the mud fly where it bursts. And that is
what I discovered next was a real surprise. I think it's time to give Tom the update. First, I told Tom his relic is not a piece of the Enterprise, because that balloon was almost certainly retired before 1862, the date on the label. But then I tell him what else we discovered.
You know, there were about a half a dozen references to Lowe's balloons in the regimental history that Thompson compiled. But there was one in particular that I think you're really going to be interested in.
While visiting the camp in May 1885, the writer found a mass of iron filings, nails, etc., all concreted by the rust on the spot where Lowe's balloon was located and supposed to be some of the baluster weights used during the ascents of the balloon. It was partly buried in the earth, but after some digging and pounding with the stone, a piece of the mass was secured and brought home.
So, you know, the guy was obviously a collector. He was collecting souvenirs.
Well, soldiers are always picking up souvenirs from the battlefields. So
I told Tom that his swatch of fabric had probably been collected by Thompson and simply been mislabeled the Enterprise over the years. Most likely, it was one of the six balloons commissioned by the Union Army after the success of the Enterprise.
Great thing. Just a great thing.
Thank you so much.
It was great, and it was just my pleasure.
Indeed it has, for me too.
In 1862, Professor Lowe's balloon fleet provided valuable information at the Battle of Fair Oaks, Virginia, where Lowe continually transmitted information on enemy troop positions. Observations made during this conflict proved to be crucial to the Union victory. Despite his initial success, however, Lowe was frustrated by unsupportive generals and inexperienced crews. The balloon corps was quietly dissolved in 1863. 2 years before the war ended.
A spy in the sky during the Civil War, the hot air balloon had become a full-fledged weapon by World War I. Throughout 1915, bombs from German Zeppelins rained down on London and other cities too. By 1916, British fighter planes had targeted the Achilles heel of the Zeppelin, the hydrogen gas that filled the blimps. The golden age of the airship came to a tragic close on May 6, 1937. Just as the Hindenburg was ending its journey from Germany, it exploded over an airstrip in New Jersey, killing 36 of its passengers and crew. During World War II, the balloon made a little-known comeback as a weapon of warfare, causing the only fatalities on the U.S. mainland as a direct result of enemy action. Over a five-month period beginning in November 1944, the Japanese launched some 9,000 unmanned hydrogen balloons. Each one carried small bombs. Most disappeared over the Pacific. But on May 5, 1945, six picnickers in Oregon were killed with the explosion of a balloon they dragged from the woods. The balloon has long since been eclipsed by more potent weapons of war. It is now quietly returned to its original use. Pleasant leisure time activities.
Want to learn more about the investigations on History Detectives? Visit PBS.org and explore expanded case files, stories from people like you, and do-it-yourself guides.
This program was made possible by contributions to local PBS stations by viewers like you.